Religions around the world are full of malevolent beings. Nightmares that made life hell for humans. And then there's...
Hello there. I'm Lucifer, Lucifer Morningstar.
Arguably history's most famous bad guy, the Prince of Lies, the Fallen Angel, quite literally the GOAT.
No. This is where I draw the line.
Sure, you think he's the embodiment of eternal evil, but his more devilish form is actually not that old, maybe just from the Middle Ages. And the more you read, the more you realize that Lucifer's character doesn't just resemble these older evils, it may have been shaped by some of them. So sit down, relax, pour yourself something a little sinful, as we tell you stories of the world's ancient dark gods, and how, if you look closely, you can see parts of them in our favorite devil. I like this one definition of trickster gods. They're about opposites in one package. Tricksters flow across boundaries of morality and reality in a way that you and I don't. Good to evil and back again, doesn't matter. A lord of murders, solving murders, is most likely a trickster.
The devil solving crime. It's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard.
And some say the biblical devil is one too. In the book of Job, Satan is kind of the Lord's messenger, scheming to destroy Job's life at God's behest. And maybe the most popular example in modern culture is Loki, the trickster of Norse mythology. But if you've just seen the movies, you might not know how bizarre and bad he can get. On the bizarre side, he shapeshifts into a mare to lure away a stallion that was causing his fellow gods to lose a bet, although he instigated the whole thing. He ends up having a horse baby because of it, so that's weird, but he's also incredibly devilish. He successfully carries out a wicked plot to kill Baldur, the god of light and purity, and then disguises himself again to act as a one-man veto when Baldur gets a chance to escape hell. Literally won't let someone escape hell. This should be familiar.
What?
Finally, Loki and Satan both heavily factor into their respective ends of the world, but that horse is all Loki. Still, it's important to remember that not all tricksters are satanic levels of bad. Eshu is a popular god of the Yoruba people of West Africa, although his worship has spread to the Americas as well. Like many tricksters, he's a cosmic messenger, god of crossroads, a prankster. He does directly cause destruction, but scholars see him more as an agent provocateur. To be blunt, he stirs the shit. One story goes like this. Once upon a time, two farmers came across Eshu on the road. Each looked at him, and each saw him wearing a different color hat. It's like that damn dress. The farmers started violently arguing about the color, which turned into such a fierce brawl that they were brought before the king. Suddenly, Eshu appeared and said, essentially, "That's why you don't forget to sacrifice to Eshu." It's a bit like how Lucifer goes to extraordinary lengths to troll Dan. Unfortunately, unenlightened Christian missionaries in the 19th century called Eshu the devil, and what's worse, they wrote that into dictionaries that stuck with us. It was actually only a few years ago that Google stopped translating Eshu as Satan. He's far from it. The devil may be part trickster, but a trickster isn't always all bad. In the fifth season of Lucifer, Ella is constantly drawn to the bad boy.
Bad boy alert.
No surprise then that Miss Lopez gets along great with Lucifer too. So Ella would probably be really into mythology's bad boys, the celestial rebels. After all, Lucifer isn't just some wily prankster. He's also an angelic prince who led a popular revolt against God.
Oh, Saint Lucifer. Suits me, don't you think?
It's in the Bible too. Here's the passage about Lucifer's deepest desires. "For you have said in your heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God." And the pantheons of Earth are full of such ambitious upstarts. In Hawaii and other parts of the Pacific, there's Kanaloa, or his equivalent. He's god of the sea, a close partner to Kane. They were so close they would finish each other's godly duties. One would find fresh water, the other would extract it. In one version of the tale, though, Kanaloa grew angry that he wasn't allowed awa, a sacred drink, or he was bitter that he couldn't replicate Kane's creation of man, so he marshaled a force to defeat Kane and the rest of the gods. He lost and was sentenced to rule the underworld. Oh yeah, and did I mention he's a giant evil-smelling squid sometimes? Kanaloa is not always evil, but aside from that squid twist, angry over forbidden drinks sounds pretty familiar, right? And families are indeed sometimes the genesis of these heavenly rebellions, like in the case of Set. He was the dog-faced god of deserts, darkness, chaos, storms, and foreigners, all of which ancient Egyptians disliked. He was also the brother of Osiris, ruler of the gods, protector of life and vegetation. Set coveted Osiris's position and wanted revenge after his shape-shifting wife got pregnant with Osiris's baby. Ooh. So he lured him into a specially tailored coffin, which Set then pushed into a river. Unfortunately for Team Evil God Everywhere, Set never actually got the throne because Osiris's posthumously conceived son, Horus, thwarted him at every turn. But scholars think that Set's connection to the desert and his affinity for the color red may have later shaped the stories and the look of the Christian devil. In his long history, Set's not always evil either, but what a rebel. I mean, at least he successfully killed the ruler of the gods.
Take that back.
When Lucifer wants revenge on Dan, the first weapon he goes for is a snake.
I gotta think bigger. I mean, it's not even poisonous.
It's a smart choice, because scientists believe humans are hardwired to just fear snakes, possibly explaining why both good and bad serpents fill the world's ancient religions. But it's also a fitting choice because they also fill the Bible. The Book of Revelations has been read to suggest that Satan appears in the guise of a serpent, both in the beginning and at the end of everything. As if the serpent that was here before us will outlast us all!
Sounds ominous.
And some see similarities between the serpents and dragons and sea monsters of the Bible, and a bunch of Near Eastern deities of chaos and the ocean. Tiamat was one of the gods of salt water. And despite being a chaos dragon, she wasn't exactly evil until her husband Apsu, the god of fresh water, grew tired of their noisy children, like they were suburbanites whose kids had started a heavy metal band in the garage. But the kids caught wind of the budding plot and attacked first.
This is hardly a fair fight.
Killing Apsu. So Tiamat went all out in her revenge. She got herself a new man and birthed an army of monstrous children in her bloodlust to get rid of her old ones. Alas, Marduk, her son, and the god of thunder finally killed her and then built heaven and earth out of her oceanic carcass. And sure enough, the original version of the Book of Genesis speaks of Teom, the deep, which, according to many, has some linguistic connection to Tiamat. And at the end of the world, there are serpents like Jormungandr, Loki's child, that destroy the earth in climactic battles with, well, thunder gods. So serpents can be a sign that something big's coming. Just be thankful Satan's terrifying reptilian form only comes out once in a while. As I get older, I can tell you there's sometimes nothing worse than your own reflection, which is how a lot of gods must feel, because evil gods are often shadowy reflections of their divine counterparts. The important 4th century Christian scholar St. Augustine had a great term for it. He called the devil the ape of God, which didn't mean he was a literal ape, it meant he was a mimic, a dark mirror. Theologians believe that the devil has his own trinity. He held his own twisted Sabbath with witches and conducted his own perverted baptism. No joke, followers kissed his butt to seal the deal. But you'd be amazed at how literal the mirror motif could be. Quetzalcoatl was a creator god of wind, rain, agriculture, and science that showed up in an array of civilizations in Mesoamerica, including the Aztec one. While his story sometimes intertwines with human rulers, he did have some special connection to the semi-mythical paradise of Tolan. But in the Aztec tradition, Quetzalcoatl had a brother, Tezcatlipoca, the god of night and sorcery with whom he fought throughout the ages. They were alike, young, handsome, preferred princesses. For some reason, the sources take time to report both were well endowed.
Well, it's not like he has a forked penis or anything.
Oh, he doesn't.
And one more thing reinforced that whole mirror theme. In some tales, Tezcatlipoca had a dark mirror as a foot. It was made of obsidian, and it could see the thoughts and deeds of humans. But unlike his brother, Tezcatlipoca was an evil schemer. He got the king of Tolan drunk on pulque, seduced his daughter, and wrested control of the city from the good Quetzalcoatl. From there, he actually instituted the dark practice of human sacrifice. So, very literal mirror aside, you can see hints of Tezcatlipoca reflected in the devil's twinning. But not all fights between good and evil mirrors are on such a small scale. Zoroastrianism, an ancient religion developed in what was Persia, is thought to be the precursor for the great monotheistic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. There are different sects, but I'm going with the story of the Zorvanist variety. An impartial, androgynous, and all-powerful god of time, Zorvan, prayed for a family. When it didn't happen, he doubted. Thus, the evil twin, Ahriman, was conceived. Zorvan calmed and regained his faith, which created the twin of goodness, or Muzd. The trouble started when Zorvan promised he'd give the earth to the firstborn. Naturally, evil Ahriman cut himself out of the womb. But there was a catch. Zorvan term-limited Ahriman's evil rule to 9,000 years, at which point Ormuzd would overthrow him. So technically, we're still under Ahriman's rule, and he's known for breeding demons and disease.
It really helps explain 2020.
You are now in your very own hell loop, so welcome to hell.
Stern, all-powerful father, good and evil twins, battleground Earth. Yep, you can definitely see that coming through in Lucifer. Okay, it's time we talked about the more carnal aspects of demonology.
I mean, carnal, really? Must everything be about sex?
Yes. See, dark gods don't just play tricks. They appeal to our most primal instincts, using promises of knowledge and power and money to lure humans from the righteous path. The tragic Dr. Faust lost his soul for worldly pleasures, which might not bode well for the random dude in season 5 who just wants to be a professional dancer. Of course, there are also temptations of the flesh. Some see sexual undertones in the Garden of Eden when the serpent tempts Eve, but some demons outdo the others in the sex department, like Lilith, who shows up in a few episodes this season. We know that she probably began in Babylon, but then spread throughout neighboring mythologies. Originally, she seemed more like several species of monster rather than a demon goddess. The Lilitu were bird-like creatures of ruins and wastes, deadly to young men and pregnant women, and for infants, forget about it, poison flowed from their breasts. But Lilith's story became infinitely more complex in certain Hebrew texts of the Middle Ages. She was suddenly Adam's first wife, who left after being refused equal treatment. To punish her, God cursed her progeny to die, and in revenge, Lilith vowed to kill Adam's children and fill the world with her own demon babies.
I gave you an army.
An army I never asked for.
She was a beautiful seductress who could impersonate husband or wife, but she was also known to be so deadly to newborn children that parents sought amulets like these for protection. She's a real tough cookie, all right, and who knows, maybe even a temptation for the tempter himself.
Right.
Some tempters, on the other hand, are known for going all in on one big temptation. That's kind of the case for Satan's temptation of Jesus Christ in the desert.
I'm so good at flipping men, they call me the skillet.
Oh, wow.
But it's also largely how the evil god Mara is remembered, as the one who attempts to corrupt the Buddha. Spoilers, it doesn't go well. Outside of his cinematic showdown with the Enlightened One, Mara is sometimes called the Lord of the Senses, who harshly rules over part of the desire realm and tries to keep his subjects in place. Enlightenment was a no-no, which is why he descended upon the enlightenment-seeking Siddhartha as he meditated under the bow tree. From the art, it seems pretty wild. Mara sent his 3 demon daughters to seduce the Buddha. That didn't work, so he summoned a demon army, but Buddha turned it into flowers and perfume. Finally, Mara just called Buddha out. What right did some human have to enlightenment? Buddha reached down and touched the earth, which vouched for him. And by the way, it's why you see this hand gesture a lot in Buddhism. 3 attempts, no temptation. Both Mara and Satan prove that evil tempters don't always win their biggest bets. One question that Lucifer raises is whether hell is any fun at all for those running it. Perhaps it's not surprising that sadist demon Mazikeen expresses fondness for the many tortures of hell.
This is so hot. It's like you're punishing yourself.
But Lucifer, Hell's ruler, when forced, is far more ambivalent, if not hostile.
It was a job, detective. Something I was forced to do.
And that attitude comes partly from the literature. In Paradise Lost, Satan famously embraces Hell on one hand, but not always. While they adore me on the throne of Hell, with diadem and scepter high advanced, the lower still I fall, only supreme in misery. But are other wardens of hell similarly conflicted? Emma-O is the god of hell in the Japanese Buddhist tradition, although he shares a lot with Yama, who's found elsewhere in the Buddhist world. According to the Encyclopedia of Hell, a very real book which we read, he wasn't such a bad guy, he just happened to be the first man to die. It's a crazy way to get the hell gig, which might explain why he's sort of a bureaucrat in many tales. See, the dead had a hellish journey through desolate plains and past crones and monsters, but at the end, Emma-O just checked his files, consulted with his staff, and had the dead look into a soul-revealing mirror before sending them to the appropriate section of hell for purging. Professional. But in later tales, he's so into it. He turns red-faced and devilish, and moves into the worst part of the hell just so he can torture sinners better, throwing them into lakes of fire, force-feeding them hot coals, flattening them into soba noodles. That's a great one. So wardens of hell can be very professional and extremely enthusiastic. Perhaps Lucifer should look into outsourcing. Our last kind of dark god doesn't need intellect. They don't bother with temptation. They're true horrors. See, humans have this instinctual and understandable fear of being torn apart by animals. We also have a built-in need to classify our chaotic world. Hey, we're even doing it with demons in this video. Some evil gods play on that. They're vicious beasts that can't quite be put into a category. They're built to frighten us. We've already seen how Lucifer has taken on different bestial forms over the ages: bat, reptile, goat, cowardly lion? But his scariest may be his final ones. In addition to the dragon, the multi-headed beasts signal the end of the world in Christianity. They're really scary, but the greatest horror I felt while researching this piece was with the god of Canaan, roughly present-day Israel, whose worship spread to Carthage and beyond. It's Moloch. It's partly because we don't know a lot about him. Moloch might actually be a title, king of something, rather than his actual name. Scholars think he may have been another god at some point in his life. But the thing we do know was that Moloch was the god of child sacrifice. His likeness on Earth was a disturbing mishmash of parts: a giant man, a bull, and essentially an oven for a torso. Drums beating, his followers would place children into his red-hot arms, and they'd either burn to death there or roll into the furnace below like a demonic slide. It's still unclear to me what anyone got from this, and that's part of why it's so scary. You get the feeling that the ancients could put up with a lot of stuff, but child sacrifice wasn't going to fly. The Old Testament specifically calls Moloch out in several places. The Romans do too. Luckily, some horrors just become memories. Maybe the slightly nicer devils are the ones that last. Well, now that you've seen tricksters and tempters and rebels and devils and all the ways humanity has imagined evil, you probably need another drink. Go ahead, have one. In the character of Lucifer, you can see a lot of those older spirits, whether it's a direct connection or just humanity's tendency to tell and retell the same stories.
Right. Story time's over.
But of course, he's also one of a kind.
Stay away! He's a devil!
Singing is a big part of Lucifer's shtick, and for a long time, dancing has also been the devil's domain. In the Middle Ages, when it was officially frowned upon, churchmen warned that the masked devil would infiltrate dance circles and dance his partners down to hell. But this might go back to the ancient gods. The friendly, popular Egyptian god Bes had a strange portfolio: war on one hand, music, dance, sexuality, and childbirth on the other. And scholars think Bes's forked tail and association with serpents shaped the visual identity of Satan. So maybe Satan got his dance moves too.